This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book Glimpses into the Abyss by Mary Higgs. Author's Preface. The author has conducted social research for a number of years on an original plan. Securing a lodging where a destitute woman could be accommodated, and providing cleansing and dress, she is steadily taken in through a period of 6 years, every case of complete destitution that came to her, willing to undergo remedial treatment. The work grew. Accommodation for four was provided with two paid helpers. The small cottage used acts as a social microscope, every case being personally investigated as to past life, history, and present need, and dealt with accordingly. The writer, as secretary to the ladies' committee of Oldham Workhouse, next became personally acquainted with the working of the poor law, and studied it by means of books also. By degrees the rescue work came to cover police court and lodging house work, and as there was no other shelter in Oldham, cases of all sorts came under her notice. She thus studied personally the microbes of social disorder. By degrees she came to understand the existence of certain classes, classifying them much as observation led her to classify objects observed in physical studies. Also, she clearly perceived that causes were at work leading to rapid degeneration, and was led to presuppose currents working for social destruction. She then commenced investigating remedial agencies and interrogating social observers. She found among them a similar experience of great waste and lack of salvage through defects not to be remedied by private action. This led her more and more to consider national aspects of the question. She visited personally Hadla Farm Colony, questioned experts at West Ham, visited and interrogated police, prevention of cruelty to children officers, vigilance officers, and others, and by degrees obtained a mass of information. But still the root problems of poverty remained dark to her, and she became convinced that nothing but accurate and scientific exploration of the depths would reveal the currents leading to degradation. After the idea dawned upon her, some months elapsed before she felt able to arrange to face the ordeal, but during this time proofs accumulated of the uselessness of any other methods. She reflected that exploration was the method of science, and became herself an explorer of darkest England. The results amply justified the experiment. She has now carried through the following explorations, each time with increasing knowledge. A. A tour through West Yorkshire, embracing one municipal, one common lodging house, two tramp wards, and a women's shelter. B. An investigation into a Lancashire tramp ward. C. Investigation of a Salvation Army women's shelter. D. An investigation into the lodging house conditions in a neighboring town. E. An investigation into conditions in women's lodging houses in a Lancashire center. F. Investigation into a London casual ward, also enquiry and investigation as to women's lodging houses in London. These investigations have placed her in possession of facts, which form the basis of the introductory essay. In addition, however, her possession of experience and knowledge have opened to her many sources of information not available to the general public. She has received much private information embodied in these pages, and has had the privilege of attending and taking part in official discussions. Also, by visits to a common lodging house, she obtained much light on the views of the class that occasionally find themselves in the tramp ward. She has also collected information from the press and studied the literature obtainable, which threw light on vagrancy legislation in other countries. Recently, she has visited Denmark and had the privilege of investigating the working of the poor law system. The official view was obtained, and workhouses, etc., visited, and the system seen in operation. But also, by a visit to Salvation Army headquarters in Copenhagen, and from other sources, she obtained as thorough an idea as possible of the actual working of the nation's remedies for poverty. Also, the connection of the poor law with the municipality was studied. She also undertook a literary investigation into deterioration of human personality, viewed from the psychological, medical, and religious points of view, writing an essay which won the Gibson Prize at Girton, 1905. It seemed to be the necessary corollary to the acquisition of a wide collection of facts to form some unitary theory capable of correlating them. A very simple theory, which will be found to accord with Plato's diagnosis of the degeneration of a state or an individual, with Meyer's disintegrations of personality, and with James's phenomena of religious experience, therefore underlies this essay, but it is apart from its objects to do more than state it. It is enunciated more fully in an article in the Contemporary Review, now out, entitled Mankind in the Making. It is this. A. The psychology of the individual retraces the path of the psychology of the race. B. In any given individual, the whole path climbed by the foremost classes or races may not be retraced. Therefore, numbers of individuals are permanently stranded on lower levels of evolution. Society can quicken evolution by right social arrangements, scientific in principle. C. Granted that any individual attains a certain psychical evolution in normal development, either evolution or devolution lies before him. Wrong social conditions lead to widespread devolution. The retrograde unit retraces downwards the upward path of the race and can only be reclaimed along this path by wise social legislation, bringing steady pressure to bear along the lines of evolution, barring extraordinary religious phenomena which often reclaim individuals or communities. D. Society has now arrived at a point of development when these facts must be recognized, and the whole question of the organization of humanity put on a scientific basis. It will then be possible to reduce the sciences of sociology and psychology to scientific order, and our national treatment of such questions as vagrancy will be no longer purely empirical. Note, the Committee on Vagrancy, before which the author appeared as a witness, see Appendix IV, was sitting during the months occupied in the writing of this book. Its conclusions, with which the author is in substantial agreement, are therefore added in the form of notes and appendices. This preface was not originally written as such, but formed the introduction to the Gamble Prize essay, in connection with which the essayist was required to furnish a history of personal research in connection with the subject chosen. Chapter 1. Vagrancy. Introduction. The word vagrancy, from the Latin vagare, to wander, now implies a crime against civilized society, Vagrancy Report footnote. Laws to restrain or abolish it form part of the code of European and other civilized states. Nevertheless, the fact of vagrancy is one deep-rooted in human nature. The tendency to it recurs both in the individual and in the race. In one stage of development, the child, unless restrained by watchful care, is essentially a vagrant, and a roaming fit seizes many of us at times. Before considering, therefore, historically, the legislation and remedies applied to the crime of vagrancy, it will be well to dwell briefly on the underlying reasons for it. I. Vagrancy as an underlying social factor. If we take the history of any country, we find that human life has covered it at different times, much as geological strata cover the face of the earth. In Victoria Cave, Settle, for instance, human remains and relics of the corresponding animal and social life were actually found stratified. If you take the lowest stratum of society in any country, the Aboriginal man was, and still is, in countries where Aborigines survive, a vagrant. The nomad is the foundation stone of human society. He is therefore a survival, and should be treated as such. So long as mankind was nomad, the only way in which a man could be a vagrant in the modern sense of the term would be by some crime that excluded him from the companionship of his fellows, like that of Cain. A man with his hand against every man would be a vagrant. A whole tribe might become vagrant relatively to other tribes, as the Bushmen of South Africa, or the Gypsies of all countries. As civilization proceeded, they remained as representatives of a prior stratification of humanity. As by degrees men became pastoral and acquired flocks and herds, the man of no possessions would be relatively left behind as the unabsorbed nomad. But the world was wide, the best land alone was appropriated, and even when England had become largely agricultural, there was plenty of room for Robin Hood and his merry men, and doubtless countless others, to lead the nomad life. Though the great majority of the population was settled on the land, there was an amount of authorized traveling that, relatively to the facilities for travel, was considerable. Pilgrimages to shrines and military expeditions and merchants' journeys led many onto the roads with money in their pouch, and the less wealthy could make use of the hospitality of abbeys. Fuller describes the old abbeys as promiscuously entertaining some who did not need, and more who did not deserve it. Church History, ed. 1656-98. Even the funds of the church did not suffice for the number of people roaming the country in idleness and beggary, as by degrees the country became settled, land enclosed, and the opportunity for sustenance by a vagrant life less and less certain. As far back as the reign of Richard II, in 1388, it became necessary for the protection of society to legislate against vagrancy. The natural thing when society was almost wholly agricultural and stationary in villages or towns was to legislate against and forbid vagrancy. Beggars impotent to serve were to remain where the act found them and be there maintained or sent back to their birthplace. This is the germ of the law of settlement, by which every Englishman was supposed to have a birthright in his native parish. The laws were made stricter and stricter, yet vagrancy did not cease, even when the penalty was whipping, loss of ears, and hanging for the third offense. Even now, society does not recognize that units squeezed out of true social relationships must become vagrants, as surely as soil trodden on the highway becomes dust. The amount of vagrancy, i.e. of those obliged to revert to primitive conditions, depends as surely on the drying up of means of sustenance as the highway dust on the absence of refreshing showers. Any change in society that displaces a large number of units is sure to result in increase of vagrancy. Of those forced out, many cannot regain a footing if they would. But as time went on, another class was added to the nomad as akin to it, and yet its origin is wholly different. The man unable to settle because of his affinity to a roving life is one thing. The man squeezed out of the pastoral or agricultural life is another. The latter is akin to our unskilled laborer, a social unit unfitted for any but a primitive kind of existence, unfitted for industrial development, but not essentially nomad. As early as Henry VIII, 1531, we find a second class, that of the incapable, those who could not work, who were licensed to beg. The formation of this class was accelerated by the failure of the church to provide for the assistance of the poor, by suppression of abbeys, etc., at the same time that the abolition of villainage, which was still recent, threw off from organized society dependents very unfit to live a self-supporting life. See note, thus again the drying up of means of subsistence created as it were another layer of easily drifting dust. These two classes, that of the poor, impotent, sick and diseased, i.e. the incapable, and of the lusty, form the foundation of our poor law system. It is thus seen that changes in the social organization left behind another stratum to be provided for by legislation. So long as the half-feudal, half-ecclesiastical framework of society existed, there was nutriment for the individual who was left stranded. He was shepherded in some way or other, either by church or lord. But when social change left him unshepherded, the charge fell on the nation as an organized unit. The poor law began. The necessity for it arose at once when all parts of England and Wales be presently with rogues, vagabonds, and sturdy beggars exceedingly pestered, by means whereof daily happened in the same realm horrible murders, thefts, and other great outrages. Since, therefore, a transition period leaves behind such a layer of social debris, it is only to be expected that we should find the third great change that has passed over society, which is still recent, namely the change to the industrial epoch, to be productive of another layer of social debris or dust. 2. Vagrancy, from the commencement of the 19th century. If society was profoundly affected by the change from agriculture to sheep farming that took place in the Elizabethan period, and other social changes that followed, how much more must we expect to find the effects of such a tremendous change as the Industrial Revolution? John A. Hobson points out in Problems of Poverty, 4, that the period from 1790 to 1840 was the most miserable epoch in the history of the English working classes. It is doubtful indeed whether we have really recovered from the sickness of that period. The rise in wages has largely been swallowed up by the enormous rise in rent, estimated by Sir Robert Giffen at 150%. In 50 years, which in city life is felt most oppressively? Classes have, it is true, risen out of the masses, including the upper working class, but the poverty of large populations is still extreme. It is a matter of grave moment for civilized society that in London, for example, according to Charles Booth's investigations, it can still be said that out of a population of 891,539, 111,000 might be swept out of existence, and no class nor any industry would suffer in the least. For the origin of such a mass of hopeless poverty, we must look to the miseries of the early factory times, and the oppressive pressure of capital on labor, only slowly being counteracted by legislation. We have in fact added to the class of hereditary vagrants, and those driven from means of subsistence by incapacity and helplessness, a third class which we may call inefficient. The origin of this class is directly due to the incoming of the factory system and the specialization of industry. As the demand for labor in towns grew, numbers of poor were attracted. Of these, some were capable of attaining industrial skill, others were not. The latter became hangers-on to the rising industries. It is not sufficiently recognized that the pressure of the demands of capital on labor are continually increasing, and that, therefore, many fall below the standard of efficiency now who originally would not have done so. For example, in cotton mills the number of spindles per worker has greatly increased, and also the speeding of the machinery. A man who could work at the old pace might not be able to work at the new, and would therefore be rejected as inefficient, but he would only be relatively inefficient. Yet such is the skill necessary in British industries that low-skilled labor is all that numbers of working lads can ever attain to through defects in physique or education. It will easily be seen that this mass of low-skilled labor furnishes a third class from which vagrancy may easily be recruited by slight relative changes in the prosperity of the community. Also, there is another change due to wide social differences in organization between the preceding century and the 19th, which has a direct bearing on the question of vagrancy, but has been little noticed. It is evident that facilities for migration must have some relation to amount of migration. In the days when it was a formidable journey to travel from London to Manchester, the fact affected all grades of society. The coming of the steam engine has meant more than industrial revolution, it spells social revolution. It has acted as a disintegrating as well as an integrating force. On the one hand, the community is more closely bound together by newspapers, common customs, facilities for intercourse, and quick transit. On the other hand, family ties are loosened, and a vagrant habit of migration, seasonal and otherwise, makes residence in a strange place no longer formidable. As a social solvent, the effect of the railway can hardly be exaggerated. But an individual separated from family or social ties is easily loosened, if means of support fail, and quite a new form of vagrancy arises from inefficient industrials migrating in search of work. We must therefore consider next the attempt of the social organism to provide for the vagrancy of the new era, the reasons for its ineffectiveness, and the remedies most likely to succeed. 1. The attempt we shall find in the provision of the tramp ward. 2. The reasons for its ineffectiveness will best be elucidated by an examination of the actual conditions of things in respect to vagrancy at present. This will be given largely as a result of research work done by the writer, or of facts she has collected. 3. It will then be necessary to examine first some remedies tried in other countries. After this, some attention may be paid to tentative experiments in our own country. 4. It will then remain to sketch the lines of future development, and if possible, elucidate scientific outlines of possible progress from the collected facts. The mass of these is so great that for the sake of brevity, this historic prelude has been made very short. A most interesting historical study could be made of the relation of vagrancy to the ebb and flow of national life. 3. Special legislation for vagrancy. With the disturbances due to a change of condition of the working classes and to the oncoming of a new epoch, arose an impulse towards repression, similar to that which in Elizabeth's time led to the laws against sturdy beggars. The pressure of poverty, driving off individuals into the unattached or dust condition, causes, of course, an increase of beggary. This is resented by the upper classes, and if they constitute the main proportion of government, the natural consequence is sterner legislation with a view to putting down the evil. Thus, in 1824 was passed an act, still in force, by which a beggar wandering alone or asking alms in public places may be punished as an idle or disorderly person with imprisonment for 1 month with hard labor. If already sentenced, with 3 months hard labor. If again sentenced, 12 months hard labor with whipping. The severity of this law has been mitigated by the magistrate's unwillingness to convict for the first offense. But all legislation is unavailing to control vagrancy by repression if it springs from widespread social evils. The state of England under heavy tariffs grew worse and worse. Rose, in his Rise of Democracy, says that duties were imposed on 1,200 articles, a system which was disastrous to the nation's finance and to the manufacturers and operatives who formed the backbone of the nation. Manufacturers had enormous stocks of unsaleable goods. Operatives had the bitter experience of an empty larder. The state of society in England, wrote Dr. Arnold to Carlyle in 1840, was never yet paralleled in history. Alton Locke and Cooper's autobiography reveal something of the prevailing wretchedness. Lord Rosebery, speaking at Manchester Chamber of Commerce, November 1, 1897, gave a picture of Manchester in 1839. 118 mills and other works were standing idle, 681 shops and offices were untenanted, 5,490 dwellings unoccupied. In one district, there were 2,000 families without a bed among them, 8,000 people whose weekly income was only 1/2d. In Stockport, 72,314 people had received relief, whose average income was 9-1/5d. Wheat was at 65s, a quarter. Strikes followed in 1842 and 1844. Such a state of things must inevitably have led to the gradual breaking down of numbers into vagrancy. The process is a slow one. Homes successfully resist disintegration, often for a surprising length of time, but if trade depression continues, they yield. First the worst go, and then better ones follow. This leads to pressure on public accommodation, at first hardly noticed, but as it increases, there arise rumors of need for fresh legislation. This again is accompanied by investigation, often lengthy, and tentative experiment also covers ground, and so time passes. It is not surprising, however, to learn that by degrees, workhouses came to be regarded as poor men's hotels, that the roving vagrant population seriously increased, and that pressure on accommodation led at last to legislation. In London especially, the number of sleepers out increased so much that the existence of a poor class practically outside the law of settlement, and requiring at any rate temporary accommodation, was recognized. It was at first a humane measure to supplement the old Severe Vagrant Act, 5 Geo. IV. Circa 5 of imprisonment for 1 month with hard labor for wandering about, begging and neglecting family, or for 3 months with hard labor if previously convicted, or found in uninhabited buildings, or if vagrants without visible means of subsistence. This was supplemented by the Metropolitan Houseless Poor Acts, 1864 and 1865, 27 and 28 vict. Circa 116 and 28 and 29 vict. Circa 34, which provided for destitute wayfarers and wanderers and foundlings shelter for the night. But the creation of a new pauper class, i.e. casuals, needed a very wise statesmanship. We shall see later that the same need in other countries has led to much wiser measures. In England, by the extension of this system to all workhouses, the casual ward was created in 1871. Legislation since has principally been directed to making it deterrent and severe. It has never been a provision for migration, such as the German relief station affords. It does not deal effectively with either vagrant, incapable, or the special product of the industrial period, the ineffective. The charges to be made against it must, however, be backed up by evidence. It will be sufficient now briefly to sketch what can only be considered as a national costly experiment which has failed in its purpose. At first only shelter was provided, then food to obviate beggary, but of the most meager description. In many unions still only bread and water and a small portion of cheese is given, even with hard labor. At first the casual was only detained till 11 a.m. or till completion of task. But as the numbers were found to increase, by the Casual Poor Act of 1882, 45 and 46 vict. Circa 36, it was ordered that the casual poor should be detained till the second day, and discharged at 9 a.m. after a full day's task. There are still, however, many unions where this is not enforced. A task of work in return for food was first demanded in 1842, after the commencement of the tide of vagrancy of which I have spoken. It will be seen what a tremendous national experiment thus gradually arose under most unfavorable conditions. The nature of these adverse conditions may be summarized thus. 1. The legislation was at best hand-to-mouth, not taking into account the real causes at work. 2. It was the result to a large extent of class prejudice, and all homeless wanderers, from whatever cause, are lumped together as vagrants. 3. It was impossible for the local government board, however much it wished to do so, to secure a uniform system throughout the country. It does not even yet exist. 4. The system attempted to deal with a class without any effective control over them. There is less control over vagrants than over paupers. 5. Considerations of self-interest would obviously cause guardians to attempt to keep down casuals, regardless of statistics of sleeping out and beggary. 6. Official opinion would hardly be in favor of a troublesome class, and grave abuses might easily arise. To show that the casual ward is ineffective and costly, and open to grave abuse, evidence will now be given. It must be clearly noted that provision for migration is a new need of the industrial age, and should not be confused with repression of vagrancy. Vagrancy proper was the crime of individuals who dropped out of a settled, mainly agricultural society into the wandering life. Vagrancy as induced by modern conditions may be no crime. It is not a crime for a man who cannot obtain work to migrate to find it, or for a man to return home on foot from a distance. Yet, if there is no proper provision for migration, a man may, by contact with vagrants proper and degeneration, become incapable of settled existence. To prevent this, should be the aim of social legislation. This would be true repression of vagrancy. IV examination of vagrancy as it exists at present. Statistics of investigation. It is very difficult at first sight to examine the phenomena.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.